quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Hmm? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Otrigger. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you were more wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another fantabulous edition of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA Radio. This is Big John with my sidekick and co-host Steve, Archive Urbanic. He's getting into the tune there.
Yes, I am.
Our opening theme, or portion of it, The Buggles with Video Killed the Radio Star. And, of course, truer words were never spoken, but the radio star lives in all his glory, his or her glory, on Yesterday USA. And, Stephen, we have got another show to do here, don't we?
Yes, another show.
Two great programs to bring you here, folks. We have another installment of our Dick Tracy story we're currently running. And we have an episode of Quiet Please. A really weird one. First one I ever heard of that series, and probably one of the weirdest ones. We want you to write to us, too. We want to stress that. Let us know how we're doing out here, folks. Do you like what you're hearing? Do you hate what you're hearing? Is there some show you'd like to request? The archives here has over 2,100 titles now and still growing.
And, yes, we do take requests. We'd like to know if you have a favorite.
We're also willing to trade. So if you want to get some OTR tape trading going, too, get in contact with us. That's what we're here for. We love this stuff as much as you guys do, and we're here to share it with you as much as we can. And again, thank you to Mr. Bill Bragg for giving us the opportunity to be here on the air on YUSA. He's doing his little Kitty Carlisle applause.
I didn't want to make it too loud so they would, you know, get too high into the range.
Yeah, probably knock somebody off, poor guy off his chair or something.
Right, I didn't want to do that. Well.
Like that poor guy in War of the Worlds. Zingo, knock me clear out of my chair. Okay. What is the first program we have, sir?
Well, let's get into the Dick Tracy serial. This is the third of 12 in that series.
Mm-hmm.
This particular installment is called Mystery in the Hotel.
Mystery in the Hotel.
Yes.
And what is the whole title of the series actually is?
It is the case of the Black Pearl of Osiris.
Osiris?
Osiris. They did pronounce it last time, if you heard.
Okay,
and
it's Osiris, then.
Not Osiris. Osiris.
Do you hear that, Dave Lowe? It's Osiris.
Osiris.
Dave was having some problems with that, and Bob was correcting him. I think Bob actually said Osiris, but which is what I thought it was.
This is episode number 29 in the entire series of Dick Tracy.
If anyone knows the correct pronunciation of that word, please write to us and tell us. Thank you.
And the date is February 10th,
1938. Awesome.
And without further ado, let's get into the show.
We didn't want any more of those.
I will get over and turn.
Steve is now reaching for our wonderful console radio here, which we have rewired a la Fibber McGee.
There it goes.
It now tunes in programs from the past. We don't question our friend the radio. We just know it works, and we're here to share that with you. So we're tuning in on the next episode of Dick Tracy. Sit back, close your eyes, remember, and we'll be back.
Calling all adventure fans, calling all Dick Tracy fans. Stand by. Dick Tracy is on the air.
The makers of Quaker Puffed Wheat and Quaker Puffed Rice, those two tasty, nourishing cereals that are shot from guns, now bring you another thrilling Dick Tracy adventure. And there's the sound of the big guns in the Quaker plant, where they're making puffed wheat and puffed rice for the thousands of happy families who enjoy something specially good for breakfast every day. You know, breakfast is a very important meal. It follows the longest stretch between meals and comes just before you start your active day. That calls for lots of real food energy. And that, in turn, calls for nourishing puffed wheat and puffed rice. That's why they're shot from guns. A special Quaker process explodes each grain of wheat and rice to 8 times its normal size. The tiny, hard-to-digest food cells are unlocked for you so that you can use their trigger-fast food energy easily and quickly. So have Quaker puffed wheat or Quaker puffed rice for breakfast often. Try them turnabout. Puffed wheat one day, puffed rice the next. You know, there's a good idea for you to tell Mother about. She's always trying to give you and Dad something different that you really enjoy and that's specially good for you, too. Well, with Quaker puffed wheat and Quaker puffed rice, you have two delicious flavors for a taste variety that the whole family goes for. So tell Mother about it and ask her to get some Quaker puffed wheat and Quaker puffed rice at the grocer's. And then you can change flavors every day and still be getting the trigger-fast food energy you need to be as quick in thought and action as Dick Tracy is. And remember, patrol members, there's another secret code message for you at the end of today's program. So be sure you have your pencil, paper, and secret code book ready. An unknown assailant called the Man with the Yellow Face has threatened the life of the well-known Egyptologist, Dryden Small. Yesterday, we heard how Dick had received a code message from Pat, who was walking on Deck A with Dryden Small. As Dick and the ship's captain hurried to Deck A, someone cried, "Man overboard!" It seems Pat, fighting hand-to-hand with the Man with the Yellow Face, had been thrown overboard. The brave and courageous detective leaped over the side after his friend. Will he save him, or will he, too, meet death in the black waters of the ocean?
Get lifeboat 4 on the side.
All right, sir. Station 4. Station 4.
The message just went enough to pass.
Hey, what? Come along, man. We've got to get that lifeboat over the side at once.
It's being lowered now, sir.
Good, good. Come along, come along.
Easy in the mouth, steady.
Keep a level as you know it. Swap them in, smartly. There are 2 men overboard. Tracy and Pat.
Cover those blocks fore and aft. Man the oars, men.
Good luck, men. Good luck. You've got to bring them back.
Thank goodness they're keeping their searchlights going.
Try, sir. I don't see. Hold on, sir. Clear something to port. 2 points on the port bow, sir.
This way! Help!
That's Tracy and Patton. Bullard, men.
Right, sir.
Side of them. Heave away there.
Heave, eyes, heave.
Stand by on the bow, bosun, to help him aboard.
Aye, aye, sir.
Oars?
Yeah. All right, Mr. Tracy. We've got you, sir. We've got you.
Take Patton. He's out.
Right, sir, right. Pull him in, boys. Pull him in.
Now, lend him a hand.
Here
we are.
All right, you next, Mr. Tracy. Grab hold, sir. Grab hold.
Easy.
Up you come, sir. Up you come. Over.
Thanks.
There we are.
Well, that water's cold. How's Patton?
Hey, he'll be all right, Tracy. Suffering from cold and shock, most likely. But we'll get him back to the ship at once. And pull away together.
Stroke.
Well, Dick, I guess I owe my life to you once again.
Someone else would have pulled you out if I hadn't been there, Pat.
But no one else did. That's the point.
Now that you're able to talk, Pat, tell me, what happened up there on deck?
Well, Small and I noticed someone whom we took to be the Man with the Yellow Face.
Uh-huh.
I immediately sent you that message asking you to come up on deck. Well, after the steward left with the message, Small and I walked aft along Deck A when suddenly a figure slipped out of the shadows. He was on us before I could get set.
Mm.
He knocked Small to the deck, and then I grappled with him. Dick, I've never met anyone so powerful in all my life. I couldn't do a thing against him. He was so strong that he actually picked me up bodily and heaved me overboard.
Mm. I don't suppose you got a good look at him, Pat?
No, Dick, I didn't. Everything happened so quickly.
This man, Dryden Small, he knows why he's being hounded, Pat. He knows what the Man with the Yellow Face is after. I'm convinced he also knows who the man with the yellow face is.
Well, why don't we just wash our hands of the whole matter, Dick?
Well, now you know we can't do that, Pat, even though I told Small I would. But there's something I can do. I can have this out with Dryden Small. So far, we've managed to protect him, but we can't go on this way. We've got to make that fellow realize that the closer we get to America, the more desperate our adversary will become. Come on, we might as well have this out right now.
Yeah, but the doctor said he was sleeping.
I can't help that. I wonder who that is. Come in. Well, Captain, come in.
I don't mean to disturb you, Mr. Tracy, but something terrible has happened.
Well, what is it, Captain?
The thing I've been dreading has come at last. You recall earlier this evening I spoke of one of the crew being found unconscious in the storage room. He was a man with a weak heart, I said.
Yes, I remember. He's the man who claimed to have seen a figure standing in the door of the storage room.
Yes, well, he insisted on going on with his work in the storage room. He's had another shock, Tracy. One that may be fatal.
Another heart attack?
Yes. From what I know, I'm convinced he was scared into his present state.
I see. Where's the victim now?
He's still down in the storeroom. The doctor is giving him first aid, trying to revive him.
Pat, you stay with Dryden Small.
Yeah?
I'm going down to that storage room with the captain. Those two things may be linked up. I don't know how, but they may be.
Okay, Dick. But don't worry about me. I'll be all right.
Here, take my gun. You may need it since you lost yours overboard.
All right, thanks.
And don't let Small out of your sight.
Oh, I won't.
Come along, Captain.
Right.
If what you say is true, we may have to make new plans at once to trap the man we're looking for.
Well, Doctor?
He's still in a deep coma, Captain. I haven't been able to do a thing for him. I'm afraid he must be taken to the ship's hospital.
Oh, very well, Doctor, very well.
I've already sent for a stretcher.
Splendid. Give him the best of care. I tell you, Tracy, it was something the man saw.
Captain, may I suggest that your men make a thorough search of the hold at once, especially the storage room?
I've already seen to that, Tracy.
What you told me this evening about the strange apparition this man saw may certainly have something to do with this. Perhaps it was the man with the yellow face. By the way, what's that thing over there?
That? That's the mummy case Dryden Small is bringing back to America. I believe it contains the mummy of Tutankhamun's second son. Frankly, Tracy, I'd feel much happier if Tutankhamun never had a second son.
Yes. A mummified passenger isn't altogether pleasant.
What I'm worried about is the effect of all this on the crew, Tracy. They talk a great deal. Too much, perhaps. Rumors get around, you know. Before you know it, your ship has a bad name. I don't like it.
I can well understand that.
Ah, here comes the mate. Have you found anything?
No, nothing, sir, not a thing. The men are still going over everything, though, just to be sure.
Ah, thank you. Well, Tracy, there doesn't seem to be much either of us can do here. Do you care to join me in my cabin? A little coffee, perhaps, some sandwiches?
Yes, I'd enjoy it very much. But I feel the most important place for me to be right now is back in Dryden Small's cabin.
All right, I'll have the coffee sent there.
Hey, Dick, sir.
This way, Captain. Dryden Small's stateroom is down this way.
Yes. You know, Tracy, it certainly is reassuring to have you on board this trip. I'd hate to have all these bizarre things happening without you here to help clear them up.
Well, I haven't cleared them up, Captain.
No, but I know your reputation. I have absolute confidence in you, Tracy.
Well, thank you. This is really one of the most puzzling cases I've ever encountered.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe I ever had so little of a tangible nature to work with. There's so many things I'd like to know. I'd give a great deal, for instance, to know what the Black Pearl of Osiris is and where it is. I'd like to know why the man with the yellow face is so anxious to get hold of it. To make it brief, Captain, I'd like to know what it's all about.
That is all that, eh? Well, I'll say this, Tracy. I'll be a very much relieved man when this ship docks at New York.
I dare say. Well, here we are. Pat must be in the bedroom.
Yes, he...
I have told you this before.
Wait a minute. Voice, strange voice. Listen.
I have no desire to discuss this matter with you at any length. All I ask from you is that you tell me where the Black Pearl is. The Black Pearl of Osiris.
I don't know, I tell you. I don't even know what you're talking about.
Your friend, Dryden Small, practiced the same deception. He, too, pretended ignorance of the Black Pearl of Osiris. You see what has happened to him. The same thing will happen to you. This pearl-handled revolver of his may not be very impressive-looking, but I rather think if it is well-aimed, and skillfully handled, it can be deadly indeed.
Now listen, I'm telling you...
You will tell me nothing but what I want to know. Where is the Black Pearl of Osiris? Answer, you white devil, or it will be the worse for you.
Good heavens, Tracy. What's going on in there?
It's evident the Pat's on the spot. I've never heard that voice before, but I'll bet it's the man with the yellow face.
What can we do?
Have you a gun?
No, I haven't.
Neither have I. I gave mine to Patton.
I can get one, though.
No, there's no time. We've got to work quickly.
But you can't do anything against that man without a gun.
Time grows short, my friend. Answer me quickly. I refuse to waste further words with you.
Now, listen. I'm telling you the truth. Why should I lie to you? I don't know where the black pearl you're talking about is.
This little pearl-handled revolver is about to speak. I do not think you would care to hear its voice.
Now, I tell you, you've got me all wrong. I don't know any more about that black pearl than you do, or Tracy does. You tried to get Dryden Small to tell us, but he wouldn't.
Very well, my friend. I see you are not only stubborn, but reckless of your life. And so
ready,
it
Captain.
Becomes necessary
anything,
for me
anything.
To...
What are you going to do?
Pull a bluff, Captain, pull a bluff.
Kill you. And believe me, my friend, you could have avoided it if you had wanted to. However, you forced my hand, and so...
Dick! Dick!
There you are. Drop that gun, or I'll drop you.
Who is the man with the yellow face, and will Tracy succeed in bluffing him? What is the mystery of the Black Pearl of Osiris? We'll soon know. But now the makers of Quaker Puffed Wheat and Quaker Puffed Rice, those two delicious nourishing cereals that are shot from guns, invite you to attend the meeting of the Dick Tracy Secret Service Patrol. And here's Dick Tracy, Jr., your patrol president now.
The 21st meeting will now come to order. And today I have another secret code message for you patrol members.
So get your pencil and paper ready, fellows and girls.
You know, one reason why we're sending you these secret messages every day is that Dick Tracy wants you to be able to use the code as easily and as quickly as he does. That's important.
And that's why you should send at least one code message to every patrol member you know every day. That's the way to get good at it, and it's a lot of fun. But now, get ready for today's secret message from Dick Tracy.
Here it is. It's football, 10, 11, 7, 17, 11, 26. 17, 9, 12, 25. 5, 17, 6, 15. 11, 25, 13, 3, 26.
Did you get it? Repeat it, Junior, to make sure.
Okay, here you are. It's football. 10, 11, 7, 17, 11, 26. 17, 9, 12, 25. 5, 17, 6, 15. 11, 25, 13, 3, 26.
And remember, fellows and girls, that's a real message from Dick Tracy to you. Follow those instructions because something very important is about to happen.
And if you or any of your friends are missing all the fun we're having, tell them how to join the patrol right away.
You know, you just mail two Quaker Puffed Wheat or Quaker Puffed Rice box tops, or one of each with your name and address, to Dick Tracy, Box L, Chicago. Then you're a full-fledged member. You get the secret code book, the Dick Tracy pledge, and the patrol member's badge.
And don't forget to form your own active Dick Tracy patrol. It tells you how to in the secret code book.
And then you're a patrol leader, and Dick Tracy sends you the special patrol leader's badge to wear with your regular badge. And say, patrol members, have you been promoted to the rank of sergeant or lieutenant yet? It's a real honor to wear one of those officer's badges, you know. Look it up in your code book and start now to win your promotion. Show Dick Tracy the kind of stuff you're made of. There go the big guns to remind you that Quaker Puffed Wheat and Quaker Puffed Rice are actually shot from guns to give you lots of trigger-fast energy in two different delicious cereals that thousands enjoy every day. And if there isn't any puffed wheat or puffed rice in your pantry now, be sure to ask Mother to order some for you at the grocer's.
Calling all adventure fans, calling all Dick Tracy fans. Stand by for another exciting Dick Tracy adventure tomorrow at this same time. That is all.
All right, folks, we're back. You're listening to The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA. And Big John and Steve here. And that was the Dick Tracy.
14, 21, 25,
Ike.
6, 3. I'm doing this code thing here.
Oh, well, Steve, put the code book away. No. We're back on the air now, sir.
Okay. All right. It's gone.
All right, fine. Now, what do we have up next? Oh, we want to tell folks how to get in contact with us.
Yes. Good idea.
Three ways, folks, right now. There's the old snail mail. You can contact us at 1401 Key West. And that's in Troy, T-R-O-Y, Michigan, 48083. Again, that is the glowing dial, 1401 Key West, Troy, Michigan, 48083-1055.
Or also, you can call us right on the telephone.
At 810-774-0112. Once more, 810-774-0112.
That's mine.
You will get Steve's lovely recorded voice telling you to leave a message, and please do. He picks up every day.
Oh, John, you're so modest.
All right, you'll get his recorded voice.
Yes.
Nothing about lovely, anyway. And there's also email.
Yes.
There's also
email.
I was hoping for a higher pitch there, but well, fine. He can't get too high, it makes his eyes water. Anyway, email is the following web address. Glowdial, G-L-O-D-I-A-L, at ix.netcom.com. Again, that's glowdial at ix.netcom.com. And there we are. That's how you contact us. And use that means, one of those means, to contact us and answer these questions, folks.
New contest.
New contest. Bum-bum-bum-bum.
Yes.
Brought to you by Gritto. And remember, Gritto spelled sideways is... Thank you, Mo. Anyway, go ahead, Steve.
This contest will be about the upcoming episode, which is Quiet Please.
Quiet Please.
These questions are all about that series.
Okay.
Question number one. Name Quiet Please's Willis Cooper's other claim to fame. Willis Cooper is the creator of the show.
Yes, he is known for something else. Name what he is also known for other than Quiet Please.
Okay.
Question number two.
There's three in all. Number two is, what is the title of the theme to Quiet Please? And as a hint, it is a classical piece.
Very good. And question number three,
and
rather an easy one.
Third and final question. On the show, who is the man who spoke to you?
Yes, who is, quote, the man who spoke to you, unquote. And get the answers to those three questions, folks, and write your name and address on the back of your telephone number, and get it to us at the previously mentioned means, one of them. And the winner is going to get two episodes of Quiet Please on an audio tape.
And
courtesy of the Glowing Dial Archives.
105 of those to choose from, so like, whoa, you're going to get up.
Yes, a few are lost, but most of them have been located.
Okay,
we're going
to
present one to you now.
On to the Quiet Please episode for today. The episode is called The Thing on the Forble Board, dated August 9th, 1948. And the show is read like poetry, a combination of poetry, elements of a stage play. Very interesting. A creative piece of radio that never enjoyed the success that it should have. Excellent, excellent radio.
Yes,
so
it is.
You're going to enjoy this eerie story.
This happens to be the first one Steve and I ever heard of this series, too. So we heard it coming back from the first family reunion we went to. Steve, reach over to the radio and get that bad boy going.
Okey-doke.
There we go. All right, so sit back, close your eyes, turn out the lights, and listen to Quiet Please, and we'll be back to say goodbye.
Quiet, please. Mutual Broadcasting System presents Quiet, Please, which is written and directed by Willis Cooper and which features Ernest Chappell. Quiet, Please for tonight is called The Thing on the Furble Board. Me, I'm a roughneck. Well, I was a roughneck, I mean, 20 years ago. A little too old, too slow now. Besides, I got a dollar now. I don't have to be a roughneck, you see. Married, got a nice home. Have to meet my wife. Hey, Mike. Her name's Maxine, but she likes to be called Mike. Mike! Yeah, I guess she's busy out in the kitchen someplace. Besides, she doesn't hear very well. Shame, too, she's so pretty and everything. Well, you'll meet her. Sit down. I was saying I was a roughneck. Well, no, that doesn't mean exactly what you think it means. A roughneck is an oil field worker, specifically a guy in a drilling crew. Call them roughnecks like you call a section hand on the railroad a gandy dancer, a garage hand a grease monkey. Same time you work around a drilling crew for a while, you're going to be a roughneck in every sense of the word, boy. A derrick floor or a Furble board's no place for a guy with a bow tie. Because, yeah, when you have to fool around with drilling holes that go farther down the ground than it is from the top of Pike's Peak down to sea level, yeah, sure they do. By the time I was a roughneck, we'd got this one well down to 7,313 feet. That was a record. But last May, Pure Oil brought one in out in the Natrona Valley in Wyoming at 14,309 feet. That, friend, is almost 3 miles. Quite a hole, that, huh? Sure, I don't think there's an oil man in the world that don't wonder one time or another what's down there besides rock and oil and gas. Oil that's made out of trees that died 20 million years ago. Oil that's made out of dinosaur bones. Oil that's maybe made out of the flesh and blood of men, maybe, that beat each other to death with a stone axe, ate saber-toothed tiger for lunch. Hey, get to wondering. You look at the cores that come up from way down there, and sometimes the little shells, trilobites mostly, that was alive when Manhattan Island, where New York is, was under half a mile of ice. We found some once, me and Billy Grunewald, and something found us. I'll tell you about it. We were down to around 5,400 feet. We'd set casing. We began to get water, so we hadn't stopped drilling and cement off. Well, you see, when water begins to seep in the hole, you pull your drill pipe, then you let down a cementing shoe inside the casing, and you plug up the bottom of the hole, casing and all, with quick hardening waterproof cement. Then when it's hard, you drill through the cement and go on down, and the cement outside the casing at the bottom keeps the water out. Well, we had the drill pipe all pulled and racked. The cement was setting seed, so it was shut down, waiting for it to harden. We'd been coring just before. Well, you see, a core drill is hollow, and as the bit digs down, it stuffs the drillings up inside it, so when you pull it out, you got a sample of the kind of stuff you're going through. And a geologist can tell a lot from that. So there's nobody around the rig except me that night. The rest of the crew's gone into town. I was toasting some pork chops over the forge for myself, but I heard a car pulling up. Look out, it's Billy Grunewald, the geologist, and I give him a hello. Hi, Billy, come and have a pork chop.
Hi, Porky. Where's everybody?
They all went to town, I'm the whole crew.
You know, I had 3 blowouts between here and Oxnard.
Yeah, I wondered where you was. Ted said you'd be in here about 3.
Yeah, I would have been, except for my tough luck. Oh, boy, I'm dead.
Yeah, hungry?
Starved.
Yeah, I got 7 pork chops. And bread. And some coffee, kind of.
Swell. Yeah, I got a bottle in the car.
We're going to have a banquet.
Hey, where's that core? That's what I came up here to look at.
Yeah, back there on the bench. Look at it after supper.
Hey.
What?
Didn't you say you were all alone here? I thought I heard somebody talking.
Yeah. I don't see anybody. Well, keep an eye on that pork chop. You won't have any supper.
Yeah, I'm watching it.
Yeah, let me put the coffee on. Like so.
When'd you finish cementing?
This morning. Last tower only made about 10 feet of hole, so Ted shut down before we get flooded out of house and home.
Funny about that water.
How?
Oughtn't to be any at that level, according to my figuring.
Well, there is.
Is it salt?
Sure, right out of the bottom of the ocean.
That's funny. Well, maybe I'll be able to tell something from the Corps. Yeah, I hope so. Well, last Corps I looked at, I'd have sworn we were getting into shale.
Well, ain't seen none yet from the cuttings.
That's funny.
Here, your pork chop's done. Here, take some bread.
Yeah, thanks. Oh, man.
Good, huh? Yeah, put on another. I had two already before you come.
Yeah, much obliged. Yeah, you know, you never can tell what's down there. You get it all mapped and plotted out, all the strata.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd like to go down there sometime if I was little enough.
Never get you down a hole.
Yeah, you'd fit. You're skinny.
I'll stay up here and look at the cores, bud. Where is that one?
Behind you. Over there.
Hmm? Oh. Well, I'll have a look at it.
Why don't you wait till you finish your supper?
I'm just going to look at it. Put on another pork chop for me.
Okay.
Well, I wish those screech owls would...
What's the matter?
Hey, wait a minute, Porky.
Well, what do you...
Listen.
What's eating you?
You know, I'd have sworn there's somebody up there in that portable board.
Ah, you're crazy. There's nobody up there.
Getting against those stands of drill pipe.
Ah, they're just rack crooked. One of them slipped. Come on back and eat your pork chop.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess so. Only I...
What you so jittery about, Billy? Come on, eat your sandwich. Here.
Yeah, well, thanks, Porky. I don't know. I'm just naturally that way, I guess. I'm always scared of the dark.
I'm scared.
Doggone it, I hate to be a baby, but I can't help it.
Scared of the dark? Honest?
Stupid, ain't it?
Oh, I don't know. Everybody's scared of something. Me? Spiders scare the tar out of me. Black widows. Oh. I know how you feel, Billy.
There another light over here?
Yeah. Here.
Ah. Oh, that's better. Hey, listen, Porky. Go out to the car and look in the left-hand door pocket and bring back that bottle, will you? That's what I need.
Okay, kid. Okay. So I picked up a flashlight, I turned around and went outside, I found the car. Then I got the bottle. And the floor of the derrick was all lit up, and when I saw a beam of light suddenly flash up toward the foreboard board, I laughed. Billy Grunewald and his ideas. Sure, I looked up. There wasn't a darn thing up there, except the drill pipe racked against the fingerboard. Oh, this foreboard board. Well, you've seen oil derricks or pictures of them. You know that little platform that runs around the outside of the derrick about halfway up? Well, that's the foreboard board. Well, you see, drill pipe comes in lengths, and you handle them with several lengths screwed together so as to save time getting them in and out of the hole. Two lengths is a double, three is a thribble, four is a fourble. When you pull a pipe, you hoist it up inside the derrick with a traveling block, which moves up and down from the crown block at the top of the derrick. Then when a fourble of pipe is pulled out, it's held in the rotary table. You break the joint with tongs, like a great big Stilton wrench, you see. Snub a cable that's fastened to the handle over the cat head on the draw works, and that breaks the joint. Then you hold the tongs on the pipe, give the rotary table a few turns to unscrew it, you heist away with the traveling block and swing it over against the fingerboard, lean it against the derrick. The guy up on the foreboard board takes off the traveling block. You do it all over again, and you got all the pipe out, you see? Well, there wasn't anybody up on the foreboard board except a screech owl, and it flew away. So Billy turned his light off, and I come on inside. And just as I come up the steps, he let out a yell.
Yay!
What's the matter? What's the matter, Billy?
Hey, come here. Look here.
Well, what's it?
Look, Porky.
My... Where did you find that?
Now, listen, Porky, I give you my word. That was embedded in the core.
Why, it couldn't be.
I tell you, it was. Look where I dug it out. Hey, you know what? That rock there comes from a mile underground. And it's been a mile underground for a million years. And look at this.
And I did look. And what he was holding was a gold ring. And it was all carved and filigreed just like jewelry. And there wasn't any kidding about it. It was real. Now, wait a minute. Hang on. I ain't done. I poked at the core of rock that looked like a kind of petrified salami or something. And then it was my turn to pretty near jump out of my pants. Because right alongside the place where Billy dug out the ring, there was a mud-covered, but very unmistakable, finger. I picked it up, and it was cold, and it was heavy. And it was solid rock. At least it felt like solid rock. And I looked at Billy, and Billy looked at me. He started to rub the mud off this here stone finger. And as he rubbed it, it began to disappear. No, he could still feel it, he said, but when the mud was gone, neither one of us could see it. And he dropped it to the derrick floor. It went clunk, and we couldn't find it any place. So you know what we done. When we took that bottle and we took and finished it, Billy and me, we finished it in one slug apiece, and it was a full pint of bathtub gin. It tasted just like so much well water to me. And then we sat down on the derrick floor and we looked at each other. We didn't say a word. My eyes got heavier and heavier. The last thing I remember was I heard some kind of noise that seemed to be coming up from down the forble board 80 feet above us. I shut my eyes a minute. I guess I went to sleep. And I had awful dreams. Black Widow. Spiders crawling all over me with gold rings on their legs. Things I could hear, but I couldn't see, up on the forble board. Billy Grunewald climbing up the ladder outside the derrick in the moonlight. Faces looking at me, and I couldn't figure out who they were. Then I was waked up by a horrible scream. A crash alongside me that shook the whole derrick. I opened my eyes to see Billy Grunewald lying on the floor 2 feet away, with a broken neck. With a broken neck. And his left hand. Well, he put the gold ring on the little finger of his left hand, and the way his arms were spread out, his left little finger and the ring were gone. I got out of there. I run down to where Billy had left his car, and I got in. I stepped on the starter, and I couldn't get it to go, and then I remembered after I'm pretty near run down the battery that Billy had taken a key. I wasn't going up there and go through a dead man's clothes to get it. So I sat there in the car and shivered all by myself till daylight. And then Ted and the crew came. Afterwards, a state cop and everybody in the world was asking me questions.
Did you and Billy have a fight, Porky?
I told you we didn't, Ted.
But you had been drinking.
We only had that little pint, Ted.
Oh, what was he doing up on the forble board?
Did you threaten him, and did he run up there to get away from
you? Listen, cop, don't be a chump. Billy Grunewald and I were good friends.
Then why'd you push him off the forble board?
I didn't, I tell you. I wasn't up there.
Well, what did he go up there for?
I don't know. I was asleep.
How do you know he was up there?
I didn't say he was. You said so. Besides, how would he break his neck if he didn't fall from way up there?
Well, look, officer. I think it was just another accident. I mean, we haven't got anything on Porky, and personally, I don't believe he did it.
Well, so it's mighty mysterious.
So it is. But we got work to do. Now, how about it? That cement's hard down there. I want to start drilling again, and I'm short-handed. Will you let Porky stay here till I run in my pipe again, and, well, then you can take him and ask him questions till you're blue in the face.
Well,
okay. Let's get rolling. You got steam up, Happy?
I'm all set.
All right. Porky, you go from the forble board.
What? Not me, Ted.
Oh, don't be such a boob. There's nobody up there to shove you overboard. And you can put a safety line around you if you want to. And besides, you'll get impaired to do what you're told. I'm
saved us too much time already. Come on, get going.
So, okay, I go up on the Forbo board. And you can bet I took a good gander around before I did anything else. Now I couldn't see a thing. So I signaled to the driller to let down the traveling block, and he did. Came sailing down from up above. I was just reaching for it to pick up the first Forbo drill pipe. Gave a big jerk and the cable broke. It dropped and nearly pulled me off the Forbo board. And it landed right on top of Ted. And if you have any idea what a guy looks like after 2 tons of metal land on him from 80 feet up, yeah, you keep your ideas to yourself. Well, that was enough. 2 accidents in a row. The whole crew quit. They wasn't going to wait for a third. And it was Ted's money that was paying off. There wasn't any more, and as far as I know, the abandoned Derek is still there. And that was 20 years ago. Oh, I forgot to tell you something. That traveling block was right in front of my face when it broke loose. It was hanging by steel cable, 3/4-inch steel cable. And I saw that cable break right before my eyes. It looked just like a piece of string when you snap it between your fingers. I could almost see the fingers. You know what? There was something up there on the Forbo board with me. And so a couple of days later, I came back. I don't know if there's anything in the world as desolate, as dismal, as dead-looking as an abandoned oil well rig. There it stands like a skeleton off on a deserted side road and the bare yellow hills surrounding it. And it's the deadest thing you ever saw. I sat in my car for a long time looking at it. Everything was just the way we'd left it. I looked into the floor. The smashed traveling block was there alongside the rotary table. There was a little mutter of steam from the boiler. That was all. Then I heard a tinkle of something as it hit the ground alongside me. I looked around. There wasn't a soul in sight. But at my feet was the gold ring that Billy Grunewald and I had found in a core of rock that came from a mile underground and from a million years ago in time. And I heard a little sound. The sound of a kid crying. And there wasn't any kid up there. And I heard it again, and it came from above my head, and I took out my revolver, and I loaded it carefully. I started up the ladder to the Forbo board. Well, there wasn't anything up there, nothing I could see. But there was a voice crying. The voice of a little kid. And then there was a movement behind the rack of drill pipes, and I saw the pipe move, and I yelled, "Come out of there, whoever you are! Come out or I'll start shooting!" And the stand of pipe shivered, and I thought, what can it be that can handle that heavy pipe like Jack Straw's? And then there was a crash. The whole stand of pipe fell over, and I just got out of the way in time. And I was alone on the Forbo board with the thing. But I couldn't see it. I felt the platform tremble under my feet again as something moved toward me. I fired 2 or 3 shots. And nothing happened. I started backwards. I knew it was following me because I could hear it meowing like a cat. My feet tripped over something. I saw it was a big can of red lead that somebody had left up there. Without thinking, I picked it up and I threw it at the sound, and it splashed. And there it was. And I wish... The face of a little girl, frightened, crying with hunger and terror. Hands like a human being and a finger missing from the left hand. And a body. Well, I'll tell you about that. I told you how I'm scared of spiders. Well, I knew where it came from. It had come from the bowels of the earth, come riding up on the drill pipe as we yanked it out of the well. Come to an alien world and was lost. It stood there dripping with red paint, blood red from head to foot like some horrible dream. And it put its hand on my arm. Its hand was stone. Living, moving stone. And it looked into my eyes and mewed like a lost kitten. Twenty years ago, I discovered many things about it, what it used for food, that it was deaf, that it was invisible and couldn't see people when it was invisible, that if you sprayed it with mud or paint, or grease paint, makeup, then it could see people. And believe me, I didn't want to see its body. I can see that in my nightmares. But its face, I can't help wanting to see that pathetic little girl face. I'm afraid maybe I've fallen. Yeah, but it's very beautiful. And when it's well made up, it's... But making it up, rubbing grease paint on a stone face that looks at you and smiles and it makes sounds like a lost kitten yet. I can disguise the body in long dresses. She can't hear very well. And when she's hungry, I have to stay out of her way. I found out what she likes to eat, remember? No, sit still. Sit still, do. Sit still or I'll have to shoot you. I want you to meet my wife. Or rather, my wife wants to meet you. Mike. Mike. There she is. Come on in, dear. The title of tonight's Quiet Please story is The Thing on the Furbo Board. It was written and directed by Willis Cooper and featured Ernest Chappell. And Dan Sutter played Billy Grunewald. Pat O'Malley was Ted. And Cecil Roy was also a member of the cast. As usual, music for Quiet Please is played by Albert Berman. Sound? Sound by our good friend Albert April. Now, for a word about next week, here is our writer-director, Willis Cooper.
Well, I'm reasonably sure that all the characters in tonight's stories were completely fictional. At least I, for one, hope so. Next week, the story is called Presto Change-O, I'm sure.
And so, until next week at the same time, I am quietly yours, Ernest Chappell. This program was heard in Canada through the facilities of the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.
Well, folks, we are back. Interesting episode, was it not?
John, if there's going to be some comments, it's probably going to be more on this episode than any of the others.
Was that a twisted ending or what?
That is the most unusual storyline, Matt.
Yes, a lot of them were like that. I like the ones that are very imaginative and get you thinking, you know. Well, that about does it for the Glowing Dial this time around, folks. I'm going to give you those addresses again. I want you to write to us. Give us the answers to the Quiet Please trivia contest. And the winner gets an episode, or two episodes, actually, on a tape of Quiet Please. And if they turn out to be ones you, when you get them, if they turn out to be ones you have, then don't worry about it. We'll redub some other ones that you don't have. Anyway, snail mail address is The Glowing Dial, 1401 Key West, Troy, Michigan, 480-83-1055. The email address is glowdial, G-L-O-D-I-A-L, at ix.netcom.com. And the phone number
is area code 810-774-0112.
And you'll get Steve's recorded voice.
Yours truly, yes.
Leave a message and let us know how we're doing here at the Glowing Dial. Let
hey,
us know how you like
actually,
the shoe.
Actually, if they're lucky, they might even get me in person. You never know. So
Yeah.
And that would be better yet. Because I love to talk to people. So. Well.
Should we give them the questions real quickly again?
Yeah, I think we have time for the questions. The Quiet Please questions for this contest.
Listen up, folks.
Question number one.
Crackly, crackly, crackly.
Name Quiet Please's Willis Cooper's other claim to fame. Okay.
Correct. He was known for something else as well.
Number two. What is the title of the theme to Quiet Please? And it is a classical piece.
Give you a hint.
Right. And the third part of the question. On the show, who is the man who spoke to you, in quotes, the man who spoke to you?
There's a Glowing Dial blooper right there. We'll have to...
No, not really. I want to make that clear.
Who is the man
who spoke to you?
Yes.
I was wondering how I could come across and that is in quotes, the man who spoke to you,
well,
unquote.
Well, then I would say quote, unquote. Who is, quote, the man who spoke to you, unquote. Okay.
It's all right.
Thank you, senor. Anyway, we've seen mine too, but anyway. Okay. It's time for us to say goodbye.
Goodbye.
To all our friends, M-I-C-E-K. No, that was the Mickey Mouse Club, wasn't it?
Oh, I love that show.
Sorry.
Let's go watch it.
Maybe.
I don't think it's on anywhere. Oh.
Well, then let's not watch it.
Aw, now you got my hopes up. Oh.
Yeah, well, put the mat to sleep and we'll close the program here, Steve. That's it for the Glowing Dial this time around. Thanks for putting up with us for the last 55 minutes, folks. And we're going to turn it over to Bill Bragg now to give you some of the station business and let you know what's happening. Until then, until next time, folks, keep a positive thought, keep looking up, and we will see you on the radio. Bye-bye.